What I need to understand answer first. Okay? So many problems in chemistry, the way reactions go, chemical reactions, were later understood in terms of atoms. The atomic theory, the fact that matter is made up of atoms, is the basic underlying foundation of chemistry. You understand the reactions because atoms and molecules are exchanging bits and pieces and something is happening that way. And to do that, you have to understand physics. You have to understand the physics of the atoms. Okay? So, at a fundamental level, many problems in chemistry point to atomic and molecular physics. If you look at biology, one aspect of biology is macrobiology, ecology, populations, zoology and classical botanics and evolution and things like that, macro scale. But the other part of it is molecular biology. Molecular biology is essentially understanding the structure of very complex, big organic molecules, proteins, enzymes, DNA, RNA, etc. This is molecular, adı üstünde, molecular biology. So you want to, molecular biologists have to understand a lot of chemistry. And then that induces to physics. Okay? Notice that I use the word reduce. Indirgeniyor. This is very much a power of the structure of science. It's called reductionism. Different branches of science deal with different aspects of the world, and these are related to each other. And when you ask for the fundamental concepts of one area of science, it tends to point at another area of science. Usually this arrow of reductionism goes from biology or geology or astronomy, okay, towards chemistry and physics. Because parallel to that is you analyze, you dissect matter to smaller and smaller pieces. Whether it's organic tissue or a piece of a transistor or whatever. Okay? Then there are crystals, there are liquids. If it's living tissue, there are cells, then you break it down, there are molecules. Molecules are made up of atoms. Atoms are made up of nuclei and electrons, they have pieces. Okay, so you keep, science keeps analyzing, breaking down. What is it made of? It's made of such and such. Is that also made of something else? And then even a more fundamental question. Is there an emptiness? Is there something absolutely fundamental that cannot be broken into pieces? So that's the end of how far microscopically you go down. For a long time, this was thought to be the atom. But the atom was split, nucleus split, protons and neutrons. We think on very strong experimental evidence that they are made of quarks. Quarks you cannot isolate, but you can figure out that they are there. We don't yet know if this reduction will go on forever. Probably not. Probably there are some fundamental building blocks. This is part of the big questions that these huge, very expensive, very complicated machines like the one at CERN are trying to find out. The point is, an important question, something that we are very curious as human beings, we have curiosity, is what is the world made of? Material world. What are the basic building blocks? That means we are interested in all aspects of the world, big and small. But as you go from sciences that study large macroscopic systems to sciences that study microscopic systems, parallel to that, you study how matter is reduced to smaller and smaller components. Okay? So there is a parallel between the reductionism between sciences, biology and chemistry dealing with molecules, physics dealing with atoms and subatomic particles, etc. So reduction between sciences and the reduction in the structure of the matter itself into smaller and smaller pieces, smaller and smaller building blocks. Second thing is, of course, it is not just recognizing the pieces, that's structure, yapı. That's one important thing we want to learn about. It's also function. How do these pieces work? How do they bind? How do they interact? How do they affect each other? So that brings you to scientific laws. General pieces of information. The more important ones are theories. How do two things interact? What happens, etc. That's the function. That's also reductionist because the interactions in macroscopic systems, for example, interactions between two molecules, there is something that maybe some of you heard of in high school chemistry called van der Waals force. It's supposed to be a kind of force. It is a kind of force. How two atoms or two molecules interact when they are far apart. But if you now try to understand where does that force comes from, it comes from the interaction of electrons and protons, which is just electric interaction. When there are many of them around, then the combined effect gives you some other kind of force. So just like you break the particles, pieces down to smaller and smaller pieces, you have an understanding of interactions between molecules that's built on interactions between electrons. So you ask, what are the most fundamental interactions? You reduce the interactions, relations, functions to what is the most basic one. And that brings you down to essentially four basic forces: gravity, electromagnetism. In older times, electricity and magnetism were thought to be different things, but then in the 19th century, it was realized to be the same thing. Okay? So electricity and magnetism. And two kinds of force, the strong and weak force, which are very short, which are very short range. Range means manzil. So these forces, strong force and weak force, occur only in nuclear interactions when things are very, very close to each other. How close? One part in a trillion of a centimeter. In that range, in nuclear interactions, these are very strong effects. Okay? But whenever you go outside the nucleus, these forces are not felt at all. Anyway, there are four fundamental forces, or so we thought until the 1970s. Then it was realized by theoretical physicists that the electric magnetic force and the weak nuclear force are actually the same thing. And later, the strong force was also joined. So out of the four fundamental forces, three of them, electromagnetism, weak force, and strong force, turn out to be different aspects of the same thing. How gravity relates to those is still one of the important unanswered fundamental questions. How does gravity interact with the other forces? There is more discussion of these examples in the text, and I'll assign you to reading the first three chapters. This is all the philosophical discussion and discussion about science and theory and so on, and I would advise you strongly to read through that. We also start out with reading. But other than this reductionism, there is another aspect to science. Now, reductionism is very useful to break things down, to see the overall structure of science. But scientists, when they work, they all work in their own discipline most of the time. They have learned the connections of reductionism, and they use it rarely when they need, but they know that it's been, you know, checked, guaranteed by experiment and so on, that it comes from physics if you're a chemist, and then you use it. But in addition to that, every area of science has its own concepts. An important example that we will actually study in this course is the behavior of guests, the ideal guests. It's a very important scientific topic, and I'm sure many of you still have in memory the thing that you have to memorize in secondary school or high school, P times V equals N times R times T. This talks about things called pressure, temperature, volume. If you don't remember what pressure is, doesn't matter, you learn. Point I want to make, these are very real new concepts. If you talk about an atom, temperature and pressure inside the atom have no meaning. Pressure and temperature are things that have meaning for a gas. Well, gas also contains atoms, but how many? A gas contains about a trillion times trillion, 10 to the power 23. Huge number at this point. Because you'll remember again, you may have forgotten what a big number is and how you write it. But a gas contains a very, very, very large number of atoms. A gas has a property called pressure and temperature. These are very real properties. We use them to design engines. The atoms individually do not have a pressure. So this is a very important first example of how at a different size, when you're doing thermodynamics, macroscopic physics, physics of gases, systems in nature have a different set of properties that the little parts don't have. Okay. At each change of scale, scale means ölçek, as you go to larger and larger systems,